Thank you, Lord, for your gentle way in which you speak to us, Lord. I'm reminded of when you spoke to Elijah and you weren't in the earthquake and you weren't in the fire or the mighty wind, but you were in the whisper, Lord. Thank you that you whisper into our ears this morning, Lord, and we just want to be obedient to it, Lord. We want to be obedient to it. We want to respond to it with all our hearts, Lord, with all our life, Lord. Surrendering to you every day, Lord, so that you may come and have your way in our life, Lord. Yes, and we thank you this morning, Lord, that we can spend time in your word this morning, Lord. We pray that you open up our eyes, our ears, Lord, that we will understand, and through your Holy Spirit it will bring about revelation to us, Lord, and it will bring about change to us, God. We thank you for it, Lord. Amen. Amen. Yes, a warm welcome to all of those I have not greeted this morning. You are so welcome. I'm going to invite Gideon up, who's bringing the word this morning. And yeah, thank you, Gideon.
Yeah, so good morning, everybody. Great to see you. Welcome. And yeah, let's just continue with the worship of the Lord. Awesome, awesome time of praise and worship now. Thank you, Karen and Daniel, leading us into that. And yeah, friends, someone once said, we need to be reminded of the gospel every day because we forget the gospel every day. And let us not become complacent about what Jesus did for us. Let's not forget. Let's not forget the price that he paid. Let's not make it a cheap thing. And God is a personal God. And that is so amazing. He knows us by name. And do yourself a favor today or during the week and go read Psalm 139 again. What an amazing psalm. He knew you before you were born. So friends, this morning, just as a reminder, some of you tuning in this morning, you might not have heard the gospel before, but yes, I want to remind us this morning that God sent his son to save you from death by dying in your place. You know, my friend Johnny illustrated it the other day so well. He said, you know what, it's like you're walking in a line and you're heading towards the guillotine. You know you're going to die. And Jesus comes and he says, you can get out of line. I'll take your place. And that's how awesome that is. You know, he goes and he dies in your place. And that illustrated to me, you know, just the price he paid. So Jesus took your sin, he took my sin on himself. He conquered death, and now he is seated at the right hand of God, and he's interceding for you and me. So by the grace of God, we are saved through faith in his son Jesus. What an amazing, amazing gift. So friends, God is building his kingdom. God is building his kingdom, and we are part of it. We are privileged to be part of it. And you were created for a time like this. Jesus says in Matthew 13:33, the kingdom of heaven is like leaven, like yeast, and it's mixed into a large, big amount of flour, and it slowly works its way through it, slowly, silently. But we all know its effect on the bread, eh? Beautiful bread. And those of you who bake bread, you will know if you forget the leaven, it's not a nice bread, eh? Also, the kingdom of heaven can be compared to a farmer sowing seed. And the seed is hidden, but the results are evident once the fruit of the soil comes to light. And friends, we should be that seed, and we should be that yeast. going into the world, working God's works into the world. And it starts within ourselves. It starts within our hearts. That's where it begins. Our innermost being changed by God as we spend time with Him. And as we get to know Him better. As God's heart becomes our heart, we cannot but bear good fruit and glorify His name. You know, I read the book Jonah this past week. It was just part of my quiet time. And I was amazed at this book. You know, in God's heart in Jonah. He wants everybody to be saved. So, even your enemies. So there, Jonah gets the call from God, go to Nineveh, prophesy there, speak the word, they need to repent. And you must remember, Nineveh was a city of the Assyrians. They were the dreaded enemies of Israel. They were plundering, raiding, murdering Israel. So I could identify in a way with Jonah as I read, you know, through the book. I thought, man, looking at my own life, there were times that I've thought, how can God save these people? Look at what they're doing. I could identify with that. But God's heart is different. He wants everybody to be saved, even our enemies. How amazing is that? Later on, Jesus teaches, and He says, you must love your enemies. Turn the other cheek. Go the extra mile. Why did Jesus teach that? Like Father, like Son. Jesus was teaching us God's heart. So today the theme of my message is work at it. And the parable of the talents, Matthew 25 from verse 14. I just want to read that for you. For the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. And to one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1. To each according, and this is very important, to his own ability. And immediately he went on a journey. Then he who had received the 5 talents went and traded with them and made another 5 talents. And likewise, he who had received 2 gained 2 more. But he who had received 1 went and dug in the ground and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with them. So he who had received 5 talents came and brought 5 other talents, saying, Lord, you delivered to me 5 talents. Look, I have gained 5 more talents besides them. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. He also, who had received 2 talents, came and said, Lord, you delivered me 2 talents. Look, I have gained 2 more talents besides them. His Lord said to them, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. Then he who had received 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid and went and hid your talent in the ground. Look, there you have what is yours. But his Lord answered and said to him, you wicked and lazy servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown, and gather where I have not scattered seed. So you ought to have deposited my money with the bankers, and at my coming, I would have received back my own with interest. Therefore, take the talent from him, and give it to him who has 10 talents. For to everyone who has, more will be given, and he will have abundance. But from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the unprofitable servant into the outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So on a bumper sticker, it once was written, he who dies with the most toys wins, but he's still dead. So what does success look like? What is the meaning of success? Does it look different to Christians? What is the biblical definition of success? So if you were like me, I grew up with the following statements. You can be anything you want to be. You can be the best in the world. You. So it's about the me, it's about the I. So I know it's nice motivational statements. I grew up with this. You might also have grown up with that. But is this really biblical? Yes, we are fearfully and wonderfully made. And yes, we can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. But these two statements can easily set us up for disappointment and failure. And the antidote for these two statements are the parable of the talents. And it teaches us three important lessons. The first one is, we are called to work while we wait for the King. Secondly, we are given everything we need to do what God called us to do. And thirdly, we will be held accountable for what we do with what God has given us. So let's look at the first one. We are called to work while we look or while we wait for the return of the King. And friends, the parable of the talents teaches us how to work while we wait for the second coming of Jesus. Many Christians believe that our salvation is like a free bus ride, free bus ride to heaven. And what we do while we wait for the bus to come makes little difference. But the parable of the talent or the talents makes it clear that this belief is false. We need to work out our salvation, friends. In the opening scenes of the movie Gladiator, some of you might remember it back in the 2000s, General Maximus, he tells his troops, what we do in life echoes in eternity. And this might not have been true for them, but it is true for us as Christians. What we do in life echoes in eternity. Friends, our work, what we do, matters to God. It matters to God what you do because the people you work with matters to God. In Matthew 5:14-16, Jesus says, you are the light of the world. What is your world? Have you ever thought about it? It's your family, it's your friends, it's the environment you work in. That is your world. So you are the light of your family. You are the light of your friends. You are the light of the marketplace. So while doing your job, while climbing the ladder, may people see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. In the time of Jesus, Roman officials and soldiers were allowed to force anyone that was not a Roman to carry their pack or their load for a mile. Jesus taught, if they compel you to carry it for 1 mile, you carry it for 2 miles. Why did Jesus teach that? Jesus wanted the world to see something in them, to see something in you and me. Jesus, in a way, wants you to shock them with your behavior. So if anyone hires you for 1 mile, go 2 miles. In Matthew 5:43-44, Jesus teaches, bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you. And you tell me, hey, but that lady at work, she hates me, man. Or that guy at work, he hates me. Do good unto them. Do good unto her. So that they and others may notice your behavior. Sooner or later, they will connect the dots. If they've not already seen that you are a Christian, they will connect the dots that you are a follower of Jesus. So be nice to those who are not good to you. They will notice that you are different. And friends, be encouraged that the darker the place, or the worse the place you are working at, the brighter your light will shine. Jesus makes it even simpler through the following statement in Matthew 7, verse 12. And he says, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. We know it as the golden rule. So the golden rule for work is, as you go into the marketplace tomorrow, are you ready? Are you writing this down? Work unto others as you would have others work unto you. Boss unto others, as you would have others boss unto you. Manage unto others, as you would have others manage unto you. Sell unto others, as you would have others sell unto you. And friends, if you are working in an environment where you are constantly faced with compromise, or compromising situations. Look at Daniel. Even as a teenager, we read in Daniel 1, verse 8, he says, Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with a portion of the king's delicacies. And God honored Daniel right through his life. One final thing before we step off this first point is, in our work world, in our culture, it is normal to treat those beneath us as we were treated, right? And normally it was quite tough, eh? So it's their turn to suffer. But Jesus says, no, no. Take your cue from me. And the people you work with matters to God so much that he put you there. So shock somebody with how willing you are to walk with them, even that extra mile. We are called to work while we wait for the return of the King. Secondly, we are given everything we need to do for what God has called us to do. A talent's worth in today's money is quite substantial. They reckon it's estimated that even the servant given the one talent was given more than enough to set up a business and produce the expected return for the master. So friends, God has given each of us unique resources and talents to be used in everything we do, especially our vocational callings. The master gave out a different number of talents to each servant, according to the servant's ability. The one talent servant wasn't expected to produce five talents. So friends, there's a lot of freedom in that, eh? Paul says in Ephesians 2, verse 10, and this is an amazing verse when I read it. He says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Isn't that an amazing verse? You know, and when I looked at the word workmanship, the Greek for it is poiema. The word signifies that which is manufactured. a product, a design produced by an artisan. Poema emphasizes God as the master designer, the universe as his creation, and the redeemed believer as his new creation. Beautiful, eh? But listen to this. Before conversion, our lives had no rhyme or reason. Conversion brought us balance, symmetry, and order. We are God's poem, his work of art. Amazing. We are God's poem. We were given everything we need to do what he wants us to do on this earth. Thirdly, we will be held accountable for what we do with what God has given us. As Christians, we work unto the Lord, not unto an earthly boss. They might be our employer, but God is our provider. So the parable of the talents shows us that we will be held accountable for what we do while we wait on the King. And this is not to put a burden on us. This is not to put a heavy on us. No. What God expects from us is based on what he has given us. It will take just as much effort for the two-talent servant to produce two additional talents as it does the five-talent servant to produce five talents. And that's why the reward is the same. And this is the great lesson of the story. So what does the parable of the talents tell us about the biblical meaning of success? It tells us that we are called to use all the resources that God has given us and work diligently at our callings, maximizing the return for the master, while we expectantly await his return. John Wooden defined success, and he said, success is peace of mind, which is a direct result of self-satisfaction in knowing you did your best to become the best that you are capable of becoming. And this is what the parable of the talents is all about. We labor at the pleasure of God Almighty. Our work is driven by our love for the Master. And our only desire should be to hear his praise at the end of our days on this earth. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Master. So God is busy building his kingdom. And once you start to recognize that your friends, your family, your workplace is your mission field, then God will open up opportunities for you to witness. You've been given everything you need for your calling in life. You are God's poem. And realize what God expects from us is based on what he's already given us, to glorify his name and to build his kingdom. So go and be the light of the world, to your family, to your friends, in the workplace. You know, during this COVID time, we were reminded that life is a precious gift from God. So what you do with your life is your gift to God. Amen. Let's just pray together. Father God, thank you for your plan and your purpose for my life. Lord, I ask that as we draw closer to you, our desires will begin to align with your desires for us. Help us to let go of anything that does not line up with you. Help us to be faithful. Help us to be wise with the gifts and the abilities entrusted to us by you. And may we use our gifts and our abilities to honor you and for the building of your kingdom. Amen.